Welcome back, explorers and omniplanetary travelers, to Koros, the savage home of the Tetraman people, where this time worlds collide. The survival of the fittest is still the name of the game on this planet. The Tetraman use their multiple appendages to fend off worldly predators and otherworldly invaders. But what happens when they find themselves no match for the Tetraman Queen? Extreme boredom. Luckily, she would soon encounter her greatest threat yet.
My queen, we have unexpected guests.
At last, a worthy challenger. The queen would come to realize her greatest threat was also her most pungent, the insectoid Lepidopterans. As the world's mightiest warrior leader, the Tetraman Queen was called upon to drive away the odoriferous insects and save her planet from the threat of an epically bad smell. The Queen dramatically dropped from the sky to show them who runs this world. She swings her mighty spears, swatting leopards away like the nuisances they are. The Queen tosses her sword outward, driving back the swarm. Dodging the attacks, the leopards prove more agile than they look. Spitting slime, the Lepidopterans go on the offensive. But their attacks are no match for the greatest warrior in the galaxy. Spinning her spears, the queen creates a shield, blocking their goo-gobs.
Ah, man, this stinks! Retreat!
The Lepidopterans escape unscathed. But the queen warns the stink flies to never dare return to Koros. The Tetraman queen stands triumphant, her quest for combat briefly sated by the Lepidopteran invasion, now forever known as stink flies. We'd better skedaddle before the queen gets bored again. Onward! Welcome back, explorers and omniplanetary travelers, to Petropia for the epic conclusion of the Petropian Civil War. Now, where were we? The Great Ambush. After barely surviving the attack of the menacing Antrosapiens, the Petrosapiens and Subsapiens teamed up to successfully drive the Antros back to the depths from which they came. It took eons for the Petro and Subsapiens to return to their former prosperity, as the dormant Antrosapiens were formed in the dark, craggy depths below. The two surface settlers united to rebuild their advanced civilizations, crystal by crystal.
A truce for all time.
Agreed.
Stronger than ever before, and now with a vendetta to boot, the Antros were ready to strike from the shadows again. But as they assembled, a new, unknown adversary invaded their homeworld, the ferocious Fulmini. Making full advantage of the civil unrest, the Fulmini invasion took the rebuilding Petropia by surprise and bombarded the vulnerable planet. Much to the annoyance of the Antrosapiens, the warrior-like cosmic explorer Fulmini looked to plunder the crystalline world in order to replenish their own devastated homeworld. Facing immediate extinction, the three feuding tribes of Petropia did the unthinkable. They set aside their external differences and joined forces.
In the name of Petropia, we fight together.
As one, they forged a new weapon, the Fox Petropia, a supersonic attack, the likes of which the galaxy had never seen. The Oral Riptide drove the black-hearted Fulmini back into the black hole from which they had emerged. Endless civil war had threatened to tear Petropia apart, but it was an outside threat that ultimately united its citizens and saved their jewel of a planet. With no more wars to be fought, what would the aliens of Petropia do with all their free time? Stay tuned! Welcome back, omniplanetary travelers, to the inimitable inferno that is the planet Pyros, where the locals are playing host to some visiting celestial speedsters. The arrival of a special delegation from Kinet represents the first meeting of these interstellar neighbors. The Kinacelleran ambassadors are met with open flames by the Pyronite leaders, a warm welcome if there ever was one. But diplomacy takes time and patience, which doesn't come easily to such excitable extraterrestrials on both sides. While the elders do the talking, the young Pyronites slip away and hold a crash course on their most prized planetary pastime, locally known as Magma Ball, for the benefit of their younger guests.
Think fast, hot stuff! Go, go!
The Kinacelleran sure are quick on the uptake. Here's hoping the home team can keep up with the novices. Alas, this nimble newbie's a little too hot to trot.
I'll take that!
and a sizzling interception. The Pyronites are turning up the heat. Not even a Kinocellarin can feel that kind of fire.
No!
But that doesn't prevent an immediate rematch.
Best of three, Tenderfoot?
Bring it on, Hotshot!
Huh? What? Oops, busted. What will the elders have to say about this? Quite a bit, it seems.
What say we raise the stakes?
And the game's back on. But this time, the teams are mixing it up. With Pyronites and Kinocellarins playing on both sides, it's a double dose of fast and fiery, swift and spicy. A perfect pass play between teammates and... goal! Whatever the elders may be doing, the young ones have already mastered interplanetary relations. Onward! Welcome back, Omniplanetary Travelers, for a quick pit stop at Kinnet. Kinnet is home to the fastest species in the galaxy, the Kinocellarins. Constantly moving, Kinocellarins used speed to survive their dangerous electrical atmosphere. This led to numerous land speed records that could never be broken by another species. And while they themselves had been unable to match their own speed milestones for centuries, that didn't stop new Kinocellarins from seeking out the record. These dark times were coined the Slow Age by Kinocellarin historians.
We've set the bar too high! Ah!
Surprisingly, the end of this snail-paced eon drew near with the arrival of the Arborean Pelorota. Known for curling into a ball and rolling at high speeds, these rough and round aliens were no slouches themselves when it came to challenging the laws of physics. Afraid of the imminent invasion of the Arborean Pelorota,
this doesn't look good.
The Kinocellarins rallied their troops to defend their planet.
But no one can keep up with us.
Equipped with electric charged spears, the Kinocellarin soldiers were armed and ready to swoop into action.
Surround the perimeter! They won't know what hit them!
The invaders landed, but were quickly greeted by the entire Kinocellarin army.
Surprise! We come in peace with a solution to your Kinocellarin problem, the perfect spheroid.
In a monumental offering between worlds, the Arborean Pelorota gifted the Kinocellarins a rapid solution. The speedster slammed the brakes on their attack and accepted the offer with grace. They jumped into their new spheroids and were off, accelerating faster than ever before.
A new record! Woohoo!
This marked the end of the slowest years on record, and the rest is, well, history. Welcome, Omniplanetary Travelers and Interdimensional Voyagers to Echoplecton, home to the sensational cell splitter Slapback, who's about to cross paths with a fiery favorite. Let's take a closer look, shall we? Behold, a bustling metropolis of a planet, positively teeming with these industrious indigenes, the Echoplectoids, distinguished by their amoebic ability to subdivide into smaller, denser pairs. Both a biological marvel and a logistical nuisance. Apply that en masse, ad infinitum.
Excuse me. Pardon me. Oopsie. Sorry.
And pretty soon, the whole planet's down to standing room only. Good thing this species knows the value of the greater good. Seems these fine fellows have volunteered to leave home and scour the omniverse for the most precious resource they know, space. Looks like their expedition's gonna be a bit more crowded than expected.
Not again.
Ooh, and bumpier to boot. With their ship overloaded, the Echoplectoids must set down on the closest planet, none other than Pyros, smack dab in the middle of their holiday ice egg festival.
Party crashers, this is a no-bummer zone!
We come in peace! We come in peace! We just need a little space! See?
Well, so long as you don't mind the heat!
Despite initial tensions, these exponential extraterrestrials are fitting right in. Their power is perfectly suited to the Pyronites' love of all things extreme. At least most of the time.
Not again!
An adventure to the 10th power indeed. But we mustn't linger. Onward! Welcome, omniplanetary travelers, to Terra Dino. Just in time for a punch-up of prehistorical proportions. Amidst a harsh landscape run by reptilians, we find a venue of sorts. Outsiders enter this terror dome at their own peril, and by invitation only, from the Voxosaurians. Native to Terra Dino, they cherish nothing more than a test of strength and skill in the arena.
Welcome, all species, to the Voxosaurian Gladiatorial Games! To your left, the Voxosaurian champions, Grile, Basher, and Terra Dino's hero, Claymore! And to our right, let's give a warm welcome to the Apoplexian's very own, Dario! Swiftfoot! And their mightiest champion, Mock!
A face-off for the ages. Feline fury meets Mesozoic might. Now that's gotta hurt. Close call, kitty cat. Ooh, that move is an Apoplexian classic. It's down to two. One fighter from each side. A sonic strike puts the furball on the back foot. But he's not giving up that easily. It's tooth and nail, tail, and claw. The champ rushes in to finish the fight. The challenger meets him in the middle. And he's down!
Mark hates losing, but that was one heck of a fight!
But the mark of a true champion is his sportsmanship. And even in victory, a host honors his guest.
Mark will be back next year! I'll bring the pain, and Apoplexians will be champs! Mark my words!
Well, that's enough roughhousing for this stop. Onward! Welcome back, interplanetary explorers, to the ever-confounding Formus and its armored armada, out to conquer the unconquerable. After centuries of hoarding energy destroyed their homeworld, the Formani boarded their mothership, Formus II, and began their cosmic conquest. Flanked by a fleet of battleships, Formus II became both a planet and an attack ship. Capable of obliterating anything in its path, as well as deploying Formani troops by the thousands, masters of boots-on-the-ground invasion. Today, the Formani set their sights on Koros, home to the Tetramans. The legions anticipate a decisive victory over their feudal foes. But what's this? No beachhead? No battle lines? Impossible!
Perimeter is undefended, sir. They must have retreated before we landed. First infantry storming the royal palace now!
Can it be the Tetramans aren't even home? A shocking discovery indeed. It turns out there's a difference between deserted and uninhabited. A truth the Formani seem to be learning the hard way.
Retreat! Retreat! Back to the mothership!
As for all those missing locals, why, they're off on an interstellar invasion of their own. A Formus, no less. Oh, if only they'd known what we do.
I don't know what to tell you, Majesty.
The four-armed flotilla flips a Yui, deprived of the glory they crave. Passing the returning Formani en route. Spaceships in the night. Perhaps the key to omniplanetary peace is bad timing? Until the next unsuccessful invasion, onward! Greetings, great explorers, and hurry, we're running fashionably late to the endless party planet of Apoplexia. Where the tiger-like Apoplexians are kings of the jungle. A jungle shindig, that is. Their world's tall trees are superb scratching posts, perfect for climbing up and up. Now that's a cat canopy. The sandy surface below acts as one big litter box, but let's leave that sand trap to your imagination. It's not all catnaps on Apoplexia, though. Using their heightened dexterity, the Apoplexians leap from tree to tree to surprise their friends and family, just for fun. Yes, this civilization is one giant rumble royale. And as the Apoplexians wrestle their way through the day, word of this rocking good time travels at light speed to Petropia. Although civil war has ended here, rebuilding society is a lot of work.
I don't know about you, but I need a vacation.
and the Petropians set out for some much-needed rest and relaxation. Once they arrive on Apoplexia, they realize they're no match for this rumble in the jungle. The Petropians can't keep up with the charismatic and energetic natives. As a last-ditch effort to join in on the party, the Petropians create a giant crystal structure and blast energy beams at it to create a nightlight for their gracious hosts. However, it accidentally generates a super laser pointer, sending light refracting across the planet's surface.
What is this light I must chase but can't catch?
The party animals scale the trees and eventually the entire planet, but no matter how hard they try, they can never catch the lasers. Don't worry, these cool cats always land on their feet. Well, most of the time. The fun continues here and throughout the galaxy. Party onward! Salutations, Omnivoyagers! Today we alight once again on Arburia. Just in time for a big beach brouhaha. It's the season of sun and surf. And the Arburian Pelorotas are out in droves, soaking up rays and catching waves.
Nice! Still a few spots left.
But more than warm weather and sensational swells, summer brings tourists.
Make way! Coming through!
The Voxosaurians are known throughout the galaxy for their bravery, their brawn, and a certain lack of etiquette.
Bro, let's get this party started!
Friendly feats of strength soon turn into destruction and devastation. Even if it's on a small scale.
Beat it! If you can't share the beach, you can vacate someplace else.
Oh, yeah? How about we fight for it?
Oh, it's on. The Pelorotas are uniquely equipped to withstand your standard slugfest. But there's no getting around that tail. Talk about making a splash. Now that's something both sides can appreciate. After all, what's the use in fighting when there's fun to be had?
Right!
Just goes to show that even if you're from another planet, you can always find a little common ground. Onward! Welcome back, Omniplanetary Travelers, to the swamp world of Lepidoptera. You know the drill. Plug your noses. Lepidopterans rarely leave their peaceful planet, but when they do, their odoriferous swarms leave behind a stench that can take eons to flush. At least the cosmic janitor business is booming. But they would soon get a taste of their own bad medicine. When Echoplecton transports ran into debris orbiting Lepidoptera, spores flood the crafts and cause their navigation systems to fail, sending them off course towards the noxious planet. In free fall, the Echoplectons bump into each other, multiplying and downsizing so many times.
Not again!
They became like tiny flakes of snow that piled up on a mountaintop. Their weight caused the peak to cave in. The Lepidopterans found their grand mountain, Mandibula Mons, dented and covered in strange snow.
Bugs to the brim!
Worried, the stink flies race to investigate this odd anomaly. But when they drew close, they realized it wasn't snow at all, but the Echoplectons. The curious crew went on the offensive, blasting the Echoplectons with gooey stink bombs. The impact sent the tiny Echoplectons airborne, combining some back into their bigger forms. The Echoplectons didn't appreciate their welcome party and counterattacked, crushing the transport. The Lepidopterans weren't amused.
Back off, Bugs! You're about to get swarmed!
The Echoplectons threw their hands up.
We come in peace! We just need some space!
Luckily, the Lepidopterans had plenty of that.
As long as you don't mind the smell!
The Echoplectons made themselves at home, and the Lepidopterans weren't upset. In fact, they enjoyed the company. Onward!
you've been watching the Cartoon Network YouTube channel. If you want more awesome stuff like this, click the subscribe button.